Jesus rewards faithful choices. Therefore, we should deny ourselves and follow him. Let me ask you something. Do you have a piggy bank? I know it's a strange question, but frankly, I think the whole device of a piggy bank is a little bit odd. A bank in the shape of a pig? I mean, come on, what's that about? But think about the way you use a piggy bank. Every time you put something into it, it costs you something, doesn't it? You're basically saying that I'm going to give up something that I might enjoy right now in order to enjoy something better down the line. Well, I think that's an important principle that we need to understand from our online Sunday school lesson about Matthew chapter 16. In this passage, we learn that Jesus took his disciples to the district of Caesarea Philippi. This was a city in the ancient Roman Empire that was strongly associated with the worship of pagan gods. In fact, there was even a hillside in that area that had little niches carved into it where the local people would place statues of pagan gods. And Jesus brought his disciples to this area, and he asked them an important question. He said, "Hey guys, who do the people say that I am?" Now, Jesus knew what the people thought about him. But he was trying to engage his disciples' minds by asking them questions. And when he asked them this question, his disciples said, "Well, some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, some say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets come back to life." And those answers reveal that there was a lot of misunderstanding about who Jesus was. There actually were not a ton of people who did understand who Jesus was or believe that he was who he claimed to be. But then Jesus asked his disciples, "Okay, guys, who do you say that I am?" And Peter responded by saying, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You're not like all these dead gods represented around us." And Jesus commends Peter for his faith. And he says, "Peter, upon the rock of that confession, upon that kind of faith, I will build my church." Now, this is a good opportunity for us to talk about what exactly a church is. If I were to ask you what a church is made of, what would you say? A lot of people would probably say, well, churches are made of wood and bricks and carpet and doors and things like that. Of course, that's not actually what churches are made of. Churches are made of people. In order for a church to be built, one person expresses faith in Christ and then encourages another person to express the same kind of faith. And as more and more people express faith in Christ, the church is built. It grows. It multiplies. And Jesus said that he would build his church on that kind of faith. And in this passage, Jesus went on to talk about what it would cost for people to have this kind of faith. First, he spoke about what it would cost him. He would have to suffer. He would have to die and be raised from the dead. Now, Peter objected to this because Peter loved Jesus and didn't want anything to happen to him. But when Peter objected, Jesus rebuked Peter in the strongest terms possible. He said, "Get behind me, Satan." Now, why would Jesus speak to Peter so sternly? Well, it's because Christ's sacrifice was the very reason why he came to earth. It was central to his mission. Jesus had to die for the sins of humanity. If he didn't offer his life as a substitutionary payment, then there would be absolutely no hope for us. No hope for forgiveness, no hope for reconciliation with God, no hope for eternity in heaven. But because Jesus was willing to give his life as a ransom for sin, then all those who choose to place their faith in his death, burial, and resurrection can enjoy a relationship with God and an eternal home with him. But not only did discipleship cost Jesus something, it also cost something for his followers. Listen to what Jesus said to his disciples. He said, "If anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." Now, what does that mean? Well, to deny yourself means that you have to say no to your own desires. Jeremiah 17:9 says that the heart is deceitful, more deceitful than all else, and is desperately sick. Who can understand it? If we're going to make faithful choices, we have to say no to the selfish, deceitful, sickly desires of our hearts, and we have to take up our cross. Now, what was the cross? The cross was an instrument of death. We have to put to death those desires that serve only ourselves, and we have to follow him. Now, what exactly should that look like in our lives? Well, to make faithful choices, to put to death the sinful desires of our hearts and to follow Jesus. Well, it's sort of like the piggy bank. If we're going to say no to our desires and to put them to death, it's going to cost us something in the short term in order that we might enjoy something greater in the long term. That's what making faithful choices is all about. The most faithful choice that a person could make is to place their faith in Christ. We have to die to the idea that we can work our way to heaven. Instead, we need to embrace Christ as our only hope in order to enjoy the blessings of an eternity with God. And I want to challenge any boys or girls, moms or dads that haven't yet chosen to embrace Christ as your Lord, I want to encourage you to do that right away. I'd encourage you to cry out to Jesus saying, "Lord Jesus, I believe that you died for my sins and that you rose again, and I want to follow you as the Lord of my life." That's the first step in faithfully living for God. But God also calls us to make faithful choices on a daily basis. When we say no to our sinful desires, what we're really saying is yes to the way that God has designed us to function. If we're living for Him, we're going to experience the joy that we wouldn't be able to experience any other way. In fact, Jesus said to His disciples at the Last Supper that if you know these things that I've taught you, blessed are you if you do them. Jesus rewards faithful choices. Therefore, we should deny ourselves and follow Him. From a practical perspective, I'd encourage you to think about the way this principle should impact your day-to-day life. It's going to look different for kids of different ages. For younger kids, it might mean a willingness to share your toys. If another child wants to play with your toys, whether it's a brother or a sister or a friend or whoever, and let's say that other child takes that toy away from you, how are you going to respond? Are you going to be like, "Hey, that's mine, give that back"? Or are you going to be like, "You know what? I'm going to die to that desire. I don't have to have that toy. Jesus says that if I'm going to live for Him, then I need to serve other people. I need to be a blessing to them. And so I'm going to use this as an opportunity to serve my friend or my sister or my brother." That's what denying yourself, taking up your cross, and following Him looks like in a real-life situation. For older kids, what are you going to do when you have responsibilities to carry out, like homework or chores? Do you turn on the TV? Do you play video games? Do you go out and play with your friends before you've handled your responsibilities? Before you've done your homework or cleaned your room or put away the laundry? You have to die to your desires in order to live for Christ. Boys and girls, I would encourage you to get in the habit of faithfully choosing to live for God in small ways today. The more you learn to live for God in the small decisions you face, the easier it's going to be for you to bring that mindset into the bigger choices you face. Learning to build the habit of dying to self so that you might live for Christ at this age, that could set you up for a lifetime of faithfulness. In this passage, Jesus says that one day we'll all stand before the Lord. We'll all have to give an account for the choices that we made and the way that we decided to live. And may those choices be characterized by an allegiance to Christ rather than an allegiance to self. Jesus rewards faithful choices. Therefore, we should deny ourselves and follow Him. Let's pray and ask for the Lord's help in doing this. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the teaching of Matthew chapter 16. We thank you that Jesus was willing to take time with His disciples to tell them that following Him was going to cost something. Lord, we thank you that Jesus was willing to pay the price for our sins. It cost Him dearly. He died for our sins, Lord, but we praise you that that was not the end of the story. He gloriously rose from the dead, proving that the payment that He made for our sins was accepted by you, that Jesus had conquered our sins. We thank you, Lord, for that part of the gospel message. Lord, we also thank you that Jesus was willing to tell His disciples that it was going to cost them something, that we would have to deny ourselves. We'd have to say no to our sinful and selfish desires. We'd have to take up our cross, put to death those selfish desires, so that we may make choices that would bring honor and glory to you, choices that would serve others. And I would pray for all the boys and girls, moms and dads listening to this video right now. Lord, would you help them to start examining the choices that they face on a daily basis and to start asking the question, Who am I serving with this choice? Am I serving Jesus or am I serving myself? And Lord, if the answer is I'm serving myself, would you help them to ask your forgiveness for that and instead put that choice to death? And then to ask, well, what would serving someone else, what would serving Jesus look like in this situation? And Lord, would you help them to begin building a track record of choice by choice, seeking to live to honor you? We pray all of these things in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. Well, that's all the time for this lesson, kids. Until next time, keep pleasing the Lord.